We're on session number 14 to understanding the kingdom. And this week I've been deep into writing the Shirith imperative, and so I'm kind of within my own mind, I'm kind of what have I covered in the series? What have I only covered in the book? And so there may be some things I'm trying to make sure that I don't touch on things that we've not covered that I've saved for the book. But if I do that, it's in the book. But we're entering into a pivotal time in the history of Israel. I want to pick up in Exodus chapter 19, verses 5 and 6. And this is about 47 days from them being released from Egypt. And God has taken them through the wilderness to Mount Sinai. And we need to realize, I mean, even the graciousness of God, we have the situation with the quail, you know, God taking them through the Red Sea. You know, there's a reason why when Egypt cast Moses into the desert, they thought he was going to die, because very few people survived that journey. In fact, Moses was a rarity. Now, when you have the children of Egypt or the children of Israel going through it, God gives them a break. He gives them a cloud by day. He basically gives them air conditioning in a desert. And he gives them fire by night. He gives them a heater in the desert, because if you've ever been in the desert, it can soar up over 100 during the day and drop below freezing at night. And so here the whole time God gives them air conditioning during the day. He gives them a furnace, the pillar of fire by night, gives them light to where they don't have to worry about the animals creeping up on them and all kinds of things. And so now we're 47 days into it, and they're beginning to camp round about Mount Sinai. And now it's time to meet God. Now, you noticed I said 47 days. That means we're getting ready to come up to Penta, 50 days from the release of Egypt, which is known as what? Pentecost, or Shavuot. So we pick up here in verses 5 and 6. And I love this, because there are several things I'm wanting to establish, because God says some things in the Old Testament that he never really completes in the Old Testament, that only find their completion and fulfillment in the New. Now, here's one of them. Now, therefore, if ye will obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant, then, underline then in your Bibles. There's so much in the Word of God that says, if you'll do this and if you'll do this, then you get this. And somehow or another, in Christianity, we have taken out the then, even though it's all over the New Testament. God always speaks in the same principles. Then ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all the people, for all the earth is mine, and ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests. Not one tribe being priests, but a kingdom of priests, and in the holy nation. These are the words that thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel. Now, just the way that some of this is phrased, if you'll notice, Peter said the same thing, that we are a peculiar people, a holy treasure unto God. We are a royal priesthood. He's actually quoting Moses as Moses is trying to get the people ready to meet with God on Mount Sinai. But guys, there is always a divine pattern that we always see in the Word, that God, when God delivers us from something, he delivers us into something greater. That pattern is always throughout the Word of God. God, you started out a sinner, God made you a child of his. He delivers you out of into something greater. And it was that way with the children of Israel, because they were setting the pattern in which we really benefit from in the New Testament. I was delivered out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his dear son. That is the pattern that is established for the children of Israel. But I want to ask you something. Based on the theologies that we have today, we're basically saying God delivered them out of the house of bondage into another house of bondage. Because the law is bondage. But is that really what the word says? God says, I'm going to do something greater. I'm delivering you into something greater. Now, what we have in Christ is a greater expansion of what he did at Mount Sinai. Because the Apostle Paul tells us that we have been grafted into Israel by the shed blood of Jesus. And it is expanded. In fact, in reading through the Bible, one of the things, I think it's in the book of Hebrews, if I'm not mistaken, instead of calling the Old Testament the Old Covenant, it calls it the Ancient Covenant. Because that's really what that word old means. It means ancient. This ancient, wonderful covenant that has been expanded by God in the Brit Hadashah, in the New Covenant. It's not old like something we threw away. It's that ancient one that God established that goes all the way back to the Garden of Eden, that expands with Abraham. It expands with Moses. But it's that ancient covenant that I'll redeem you. But what's interesting here, and this is something that I love, because remember, we're talking about the Nachash that tried to do things in the garden that connected mankind to the kingdom of darkness, which the epitome of it is Babylon and Egypt. Both are types and shadows of what the Nachash had to build. And one of the things, I just finished writing a chapter on that in my new book, and one of the things that the Holy Spirit led me to write is, you know, the Nachash started out in this flaming tree to tempt Adam and Eve. But God shows up. God doesn't have to go as mighty as the Nachash. He just shows up in this little burning bush. But you know, all it took was a burning bush with the power of God that he started a fire on the inside of Moses, that when Moses took it down to Egypt, it burnt the Nachash's house down. Egypt never recovered from Moses. I don't know about you, but that just makes me happy. He never recovered from Moses. And now he's bringing them out. He said, listen, I'm your king. I'm your God. And you are going to be a peculiar treasure unto me. Now that's a technical term. That whenever you were a king and you ruled and you would plunder nations, you would gain territory, there were certain treasures that the king shared with no one. In many cases, not even his wife, the queen, got to go into his treasure room that was just his stuff. Now, what's important about that is we have at the Tower of Babel, we have the Nachash to begin with, then we have the Tower of Babel after God divided, created the nation's 70 people group. He appointed members of the divine council that had fallen, principalities and powers, to rule over them. But he said, you know, I'm eventually going to get a people. That people started in the loins of Abraham, grew, went down to Egypt so they would be a type and shadow of us coming out of spiritual bondage. And when he drew them out, he said, this is my peculiar treasure. Nachash, divine counsel that fell, you don't get them. They belong to me. I took them out of your bondage and I brought them into my kingdom. You can't fellowship with them. You can't have input into their lives. What is that? Because right after this scene in Exodus, we get into God giving the Ten Commandments. What's the first one? I am the Lord thy God which brought thee out of Egypt, and you will have no other gods before me. You're my peculiar treasure. I'm your God. Nobody else gets to be your God. Oh, that ought to make you happy. I'm your deliverer. Nobody else gets to be your deliverer. I'm your king. Nobody else gets to be your king. That out of these 70 nations, I have drawn and created a 71st nation that I am going to call Israel, and I am going to, and they are mine. God put his hand around Israel and said, listen here, kingdom of darkness, mine. You don't mess with this. If they will hearken into my voice, keep my ways. Why is that so important? Because there's only two voices and two ways in the earth, that of the Nachash and that of Yahweh Elohim. Either you're connected to the Nachash and his friends, and they don't care what you call their God, they don't care what you call them by, just as long as you're not fellowshipping and under the control and under the leadership and under the lordship of Yahweh Elohim, they don't care what you call them. You can call them Moloch, you can call them Buddha, you can call them Jimmy, they don't care, just as long as you're not under God's, Almighty God's protection. And God says, you will become my peculiar treasure. Principalities and powers, they don't belong to you. I'm going to teach them not to listen to you. I'm going to teach them to drive your ways out of their hearts and out of their minds. And they're going to walk in my ways, not your ways. I'm going to teach them how to walk in life and not in the knowledge of good and evil. Come on now. That's what this has meant. That's why the Apostle Peter was saying, listen, in Christ, you are now that peculiar people. You're that treasure of God. You have been separated from all these pagan gods that the Greeks and the Romans separated. You're separated from the watchers. You're separated from the principalities and powers. You're separated from all the kingdom of darkness and whatever name they go by. And now, because of Jesus, you who were afar off have been brought near to God. And God considers you his treasure in the earth. That's what he was telling them here. Okay. Then he goes on to say, and ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests. Now what's interesting in him saying this, by this time he has already established the Levitical priesthood. He has already established the Aaronic priesthood, a subset under the Levitical priesthood, where Aaron was the high priest, and it was through his lineage that only the high priest and those that ministered directly unto God could flow from. So you had the Levites that ministered to the people. You had the Aaronic priesthood that ministered to Almighty God. But in the background, God was saying, there is another priesthood that I'm eventually going to develop, that I'm going to establish and what I'm going to do. It is of the order of Melchizedek that we find in the book of Hebrews. He refers to it back here at the very beginning. He said, my desire is that you're to become an entire nation of priests. And believer, you're a priest and you have a priesthood to Almighty God. And it is twofold. It is the Aaronic priesthood and the Levitical priesthood brought together, that you are to minister to God through prayer and worship, and you are to minister to the people by sharing with them the gospel of Jesus Christ and sharing with them the wisdom of the commandments of God and calling them out of Babylon and teaching them what it means not to follow the God of this world, but the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That is our priesthood. I got a whole course I've taught on this here on priesthood of the believer. That begins right here. This is all pivotal. God shares all this right before they meet him. Now they've seen his wonders. They've seen him with 10 plagues bring down the greatest nation that existed on the planet at that time in history. Without lifting a finger, they didn't have to pick up a bow and arrow. They didn't have to pick up a spear. All it required by God was an old guy named Moses picked up his walking staff, and he brought down the greatest nation on the planet. Oh, and so, see, because salvation is a grace of God. It is a work of God. They were redeemed out of Israel by the sovereign work of God. And Moses was a type and shadow of Messiah, that he went and he was sent down from above. He met God on the mountain, and then he had to descend the mountain and journey into Egypt to be a redeemer, to redeem his people. And they all they had to do was believe to be redeemed. Oh, that ought to make you happy. And all the 10 plagues ended in putting the lamb's blood over the doorpost. And then God says, just in case you don't get it, I'm going to have you walk through the Red Sea. The Sea of Blood. Because what stops the Pharaoh from getting to you is once you go through the blood, he can no longer possess you. Come on. Oh, I made, you might as well get happy because, guys, I have made myself happy this morning. That once we see, the Red Sea is not a type and shadow of baptism. It's a type and shadow of salvation. It's all got to go through the blood to get into the kingdom. Because, you say, well, I just don't know. How wet did they get going through the Red Sea? Not a drop. They walked on dry ground. They didn't have to swim. They didn't get dunked. They had to go through the blood, through the only trail that Almighty God made for them to get through the blood. Because there's only one way of salvation. And all these people that tell you there are more ways, there are many ways unto God, their carcasses are floating in the Dead Sea. They don't tell you that they all drowned, never made it, because there's only one way through the blood. And that is faith in Jesus of Nazareth and his completed work for us on the cross, that he is Almighty God come down in the flesh. I read this morning, it was on Logos, that one of these authors, after he got saved at Oxford, he had his Oxford studio, and he had other authors come in. Many of them weren't saved, and they were trying to figure out the Trinity. You know, how could Jesus be all man and all God? And he said, well, let's say that I'm writing a story, and I put myself in that story. He said, if I put myself in that story, I have created an incarnation of myself in that story. And I thought, because history is his story. And Almighty God, we're going to get into a lot of things in the days to come. There are many reasons why Jesus came in the flesh. Now, part of it, can I go ahead and kind of give you just a peek? When God establishes Israel at Mount Sinai, which we're getting ready to read, and he does, he says, I'm going to be your king. Now, encoded within Torah, Moses already told him, one day you're going to say, golly, everybody has a physical king and we don't. We want a real king sitting on the throne like Almighty God isn't a king. And so you have to go through the catastrophe called Saul, and you get to David. And God says, I can work with this. I'm going to sit on the throne of David. And so Almighty God says, I want to be your king, but you say, you demand that you have to have a man in physical form to be your king. Now you know the reason for the incarnation. Almighty God took flesh because he said, I am going to be your king. And one day he is going to rule and reign in Jerusalem, sitting upon the throne of David. You see, God always goes back to plan A. And his original plan A, he tells us here, is I am calling all of you to be priests. There should be no such thing in the body of Christ as laity. Now we have those in the fivefold ministry that are preparing everybody else for ministry. And the greatest way you have ministry is by how you live your life. Because one of the greatest tragedies in the body of Christ today is people that live for the devil but yet try to testify of Christ. Their lives should testify of him and cause people to say, what's different about you? And it has to be more than where you spend your weekends. It's walking in the ways of God. Now, I know I've gotten just a little bit off track here, but it's all good, isn't it? Let's go on to Exodus 19 and 9. We're about to get happy again. And the Lord said unto Moses, Lo, I will come unto thee in a thick cloud, that the people may hear when I speak with thee, and believe thee forever. How long's forever? But now we have people in the body of Christ that don't want to hear Moses. Somehow or another, we have made Moses a villain when God made him a hero. Even when we get to the book of Revelation, he is earmarked, and they sang the song of Moses, stop, comma, the servant of God. Well, I don't like Moses. No, your flesh doesn't like the commandments of God because it points out your old scuzzy sin and how you won't crucify it. That being said, let's go on. And Moses told the words of the people unto the Lord. And the Lord said unto Moses, Go unto the people and sanctify them today and tomorrow, and let them wash their clothes and be ready against the third day. Underline that third day. God setting the principle of the third day. Third day resurrection. Okay? And be ready against the third day, for the third day the Lord will come down in the sight of all the people upon Mount Sinai. Now there's several things that we need to understand. The Red Sea is not where we get the concept of mikvah. Mikvah is the Hebrew word for baptism. Where we get the concept of baptism, before they met with God, after being delivered, now they're being brought to be met with God, to be taught how to live and to walk with this God. They went through ritual baptism for several days. That, and in fact, if you would, if we could get a layout of in Jesus in the temple. On the Temple Mount, there were mikveh pools all over the place. There were over 1,000 of them, because before a male would go up into the temple, he would have to mikveh. He would have to be baptized before he went to go meet with his God. Because even back then, what they were doing is this is all identifying with the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. And that I have been redeemed out of Egypt, and I am now mikvah. I am identifying with this God who delivered me and the work that he has done for me. And now I am letting the work of the Holy Spirit and the washing of the water of the Word prepare me to meet and to walk with this God. And guys, it is a they spent 2 days doing it to prepare for the third day. How many know it doesn't take 2 days just to wash your clothes and to take a bath? Why did God extenuate this to 2 days? Some could say it could be because there were several million people that had to do it. At the same time, we need to realize that the sanctification process is a journey, and it takes work, and you're going to have to let yourself be cleansed by the washing of the water of the Word. You're not going to arrive there overnight. Come on now. Now we pick up in verse 16 of the same chapter in Exodus. And it came to pass on the third day in the morning that there were thunders and lightnings and a thick cloud upon the mount, and the voice of the trumpet exceedingly loud, so that the people that was in the camp trembled. And Moses brought forth the people out of the camp to meet with God, and they stood at the neither part of the mount, and the Mount Sinai was altogether on a smoke, because the Lord descended upon it in fire. Underline that in your Bible, in fire. And the smoke thereof ascended as the smoke of the furnace, and the whole mountain quaked greatly. And when the voice of the trumpet sounded longer and waxed louder and louder, Moses spake, and God answered him by a voice. Now there's a lot in this, but we got to take the conflict back to the garden for a minute. You have the Nachash appearing as this fiery, illuminating presence in the garden. promising illumination. Then you have Almighty God to fix the solution to come against an empire that he had created, that the Nachash had created. Starts out in a burning bush, a little burning bush, but all it takes is the fire of God in the heart of one man that can always burn down the house of the Nachash. All right? Now Almighty God is coming to prove a point. He could have simply, Moses simply could have gone up and said, see that little bush up there? You know, the one that I saw? Look, it's burning and it's not consumed. That little bad boy is still on fire. Isn't that a sign and a wonder? Because that's what sent me. But now Yahweh Elohim comes and he and his presence consumes that entire mountain, and that mountain is on fire. I would say that a mountain on fire beats a tree on fire. Maybe just a little bit. This is the turning point. He promised you illumination, but now that I have redeemed him, you out of his blindness, I, by my Spirit, I'm going to provide true illumination and instruction and understanding on how to walk in that which only I can give. And it was from that point. You see, the Feast of the Feast of Shavuot, the Feast of Pentecost, is a celebration that God came and gave his commandments to men. This is the first Shavuot. God came and he spoke the Decalogue, which is a Reader's Digest summation, if you will, of the 613 commandments in the Torah. And it started with fire saying, come on now. All these masons are running around for light. God says, your word is a light unto my feet and a lamp unto my path, or a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Illumination. This is the true illumination that's come from above. And it's the fire of the Holy Spirit that brings it. And what we have done is we have handicapped, listen to me now, we have handicapped the Holy Spirit when you say, now out of your divine revelation, I am going to exclude 2/3 of the revelation that you gave to mankind, and now you have got to mature me and bring me completely out of Egypt based upon only the last 1/3 of the book. How can he? You have thrown away the definitions to everything. Without the Torah, you don't know the difference between Yahweh Elohim and Ra. You don't know the difference between the Nachash and the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. You don't know, because the Nachash will dress up like Jesus if that's what it takes to get you off, because he will present another Christ, another Jesus. The rabbis did it that caused the writing of the book of Galatians. It's the whole reason that we have Acts chapter 15. Now some point to all the Torah and say, yes, the Torah's fault. They were trying to Judaize us. No, they were trying to physically make you Jews by telling you that it wasn't the shed blood of Jesus that saved you. It was being circumcised in the flesh. Adding anything more to that, and you have taken yourself outside the context of Scripture. But Paul said, if you're trusting in the circumcision of the flesh, then you've believed another gospel and you're following another Christ. A new super Jew Jesus instead of the one that he was in the minds of those that graduated the school of Shammai. Come on now, let's just stick with let God be God. You say, why are you harping on this? This is the first Shavuot. Is there any doubt in your mind why there was fire involved on the Pentecost after the death, burial, and resurrection of Messiah? the same fire that was on the mountain landed upon their foreheads, landed upon their heads. The fire that gave the commandments is now the fire that comes within to empower us to live the commandments. We could even take it a step further. After they built the tabernacle, there was a pillar of fire that came out of the top of the tabernacle, wasn't there? And as long as that fire was there, the glory of God was there, no enemy could stand against Israel. Now the Apostle Paul tells us that my body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. So where should that pillar of fire be? Oh, you're still not getting it. Moses went down and bowed and walked, took his sandals off and walked before a little flaming bush, and it set a fire on the inside of his heart that burned the Nachash's house down. So my question is to the body of Christ, if I am now the temple of the Holy Ghost, I am now the Mishkan of Almighty God in the earth, how come I don't have enough fire in me to burn down the Nachash's house wherever I go? Jesus went about doing good and destroying all the works of the Nachash and friends. Go thou and do likewise, but you can't because you don't have any fire burning in your belly, except maybe the fire of the Nachash is still burning instead of the fire of the Holy Spirit. Oh. We've got to get the right fire. And let me say this, because right now on our podcast, we're dealing with kingdom order and spiritual manifestations. If you're dealing with a spirit that takes you away from the ways of God, you're dealing with another spirit. The Holy Spirit will always point you back to the word that he penned. The Holy Spirit is not going to disagree with himself. He is not schizophrenic like some of us in our theology schizophrenic. What is he going to do? He makes the word of God alive on the inside of us. Now what's also interesting, notice, so you have the cloud come down. Now, they don't see the personage of God. So the voice of God is kind of nebulous. It's just kind of there in the air. And so Moses calls to God. God answers him basically out of nothing. They said this with thunder and lightning. This is the reason why when Jesus was baptized, there was a voice that proclaimed from heaven, "This is my son, hear ye him." There were several times in the ministry of Jesus that Almighty God simply spoke from his throne in heaven. Some heard his voice, but all some heard were the thunderings. It thundered. Why did God do that? Because Moses said, "There's one coming just like me." It was a proof that Jesus was the Messiah. Because we see him in the type and shadow in the ministry and the life of Moses. Now, I want to check our attitude just for a minute about the commandments of God. I want to go to Deuteronomy chapter 4, verses 5 through 8. What we have done, you know, if I would go down to any place where the Jewish culture is there, and I start talking about law, they get happy. They don't go, we're so under burden. They dance. If you ever go to a synagogue worship service, they will dance with the Torah scrolls during their praise and worship service that they will march that thing around the synagogue rejoicing in the Torah. So how do we go from that? Because Jesus and the Apostle Paul had no problem with that. To where we say, oh, the law. Part of the problem is culture. Culture does not translate into transliteration. Let me give you an example. Uncle Bob died. Well, in America, we could say, Uncle Bob kicked the bucket. You go to Mexico, they're worried about what was in the bucket. Oh, really? Was it something precious in the bucket? Because in Mexico, Uncle Bob stretched out his legs. In America, we stretch out our legs as something called a recliner. That doesn't mean that we died. Because there are certain idioms that are articulated and embedded within the culture that are embedded within the language. In the Greek and Roman cultures, law was oppressive because it was the law of man. Just like law is oppressive in America, and many people are getting ready to find out just how oppressive the law is. There are so many laws on the books in America that you could violate the law for breathing because you're contributing to global warming. Now, don't even bring up the fact that what happens when you eat beans, how much you contribute to global warming. Now, that's to the point of being ridiculous, but did you know there are laws on the books that if they were enforced, you can't move or breathe in America without violating one of them? And the only thing separating you from a criminal or a violator is getting some bureaucrat in his radar that he begins enforcing these things. It's that crazy. So there's this oppressiveness. We extrapolate that out of the Greek. We extrapolate that out of other cultures other than the Jewish culture. In the Jewish culture, the law gave them freedom. Freedom from the Nachash. Okay. Now, in Deuteronomy 4, 5, and 8, listen to the attitude that Almighty God has and Moses has talking about the law. Behold, I have taught you statutes and judgment, even as the Lord God commanded me, that ye should go, that ye should do so in the land whether ye go to possess it. Keep therefore and do them, for this is your wisdom. This is your wisdom and understanding. Not this is your oppression. Now, man can take the law of God and make it oppressive. But let me tell you something. Man can take the laws of Baptists and make that oppressive. God can take the law, a man can take the laws that are established in the Pentecostal church and make it so oppressive that you can't do anything. How many of us have seen that no matter what denomination you go through, man can take some of the things they meant for good intent, their definition of what holiness should be, and cause it to be so grievous that nobody can bear it. That's what the rabbis did in Jesus' day with the law of God. He said, this is going to be your understanding in the sight of the nations which shall hear all these statutes and say, surely this great nation is under such a burden, who'd want to be a part of it? Now, is that what the Bible says here? No. They're going to look at you walking in the commandments of God, and that nation shall surely say, this is a wise and understanding people. For what nation is so great who hath God so nigh unto them as the Lord our God in all of these things which, and all these things that ye call upon him for? And what nation is so great, and what hath statutes and judgments so righteous as all this law? It was to contrast itself from all of the nations that were based upon what the Nachash brought. And it was supposed to be so outstanding to cause them to say, this is just awesome. And yet we have people come and say, Jesus crushed Moses under his feet. You're an idiot. Jesus had to use what was given through Moses to even do what he did on the cross. And even the priesthood under Melchizedek and him ruling and reigning as king is based upon the Torah and what's encoded into it. Your very salvation, if you remove the law of God, you have no salvation. Because you remove the very legal document that God spoke into the earth to enforce, to bring about salvation through the cross. Now see what the Apostle Paul does rightly. Now the Torah can convert the soul, is what the book of Psalms says. It is also agreed upon by James when he said, receive with meekness the engrafted word for the salvation of your soul. Now he was talking to believers. It gets rid of Egypt out of your brain, but it cannot reconnect your spirit to God. That takes a redeemer. That's only available through the gospel. Moses was a type and shadow. The fulfillment was in Christ. Now, here's a fun tip. Remember when Israel was murmuring in the wilderness, and all of a sudden these fiery serpents, in Hebrew, it's Seraph Nachash. It was the seraphim, most likely the seraphim that we find in Isaiah that were before God. Their job was to declare the holiness of God. I believe that Israel's murmuring was an affront to their declaration of the holiness of God. And so God commissioned them to come down and to check the attitude of Israel. Okay? So the cure is a brazen serpent on a pole. You go, what? How's that a cure for the judgment of God? God says, you don't get it. A serpent started this in a tree in the garden. And I'm going to nail that serpent to the cross. The sin that he brought was poured upon Jesus and nailed to that cross. And the Nachash, because there's no spiritual voids, guys. Listen to me. There's no, even nature abhors a vacuum. Either you're either connected to the Nachash and getting illumination from him, or you are connected to God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob and drawing your illumination from him. There's no middle ground. You can't live by the statutes and the judgments of the world. How many know the world has them? And it goes like this. If your flesh likes it, do it. Flesh, flesh, flesh. Carnal, carnal, carnal. Evil, evil, corruption, corruption. The more corrupted, the better is the way that the world operates. You either have that going on, or you will be a holy people unto me, and you will walk in my ways and my statutes. That is what causes you to be a light into the earth. That when other nations look at you, they'll say, when other people look at you, they'll say, you live differently and you react differently when things happen to you. And how come your God comes and delivers you and I'm stuck in my mess? Or how come you can walk through that situation, but you do it differently than we do? What's the difference? And then you can give a testimony to the grace of God and the power of the blood of Jesus Christ. Let me go on. And what, picking up in verse 8, and what nation is there so great that hath statutes and judgments so righteous as all this law, which I set before you today? We need to have an adjustment. Jesus, I believe, was the one. You know, the rabbis teach, when you get into the book of Daniel, there's the Ancient of Days, and then there's the Son of Man. The rabbis looking at Daniel has always said there's an aspect of God that we can never know. He is known as the Ancient of Days. But there is an aspect of God that we can know, and he is the Son of Man. So any time that God manifests in the Old Testament, it is a Christophanies. It was Jesus in the burning bush. It was Jesus that burnt down Pharaoh's house. It was Jesus that poured the plagues on the original Pharaoh's house. And when we get to the tribulation period, it is Jesus that will pour the plagues and the bowls of wrath on this Pharaoh's house. It was Jesus and his brilliant presence that set that mountain on fire. And it was Jesus who gave the Torah to Moses. So has Jesus come to conquer himself and to do away with his own word that he gave to his people after he set them free? Or is it the constitution of his kingdom? And is it finally the definitions that we need? I want to go down, I want to end this with Leviticus chapter 10, verses 8 through 11. Now this is dealing on the back end of a tragic event. They get the tabernacle of Moses built, God moves in, and now it's time for them to give their first sacrifices. Now they have been trained how to do this. They have been instructed by Moses. The Aaron has been instructed by God. Aaron instructs his sons. And his sons, in the partying, move beyond wine and drink strong drink. They went from wine to whiskey, if you will, and got drunk and violated the instruction of God by introducing strange fire to the altar of God. Now, can you see the pattern? There's only two fires in the earth, the fire of God and the fire of the Nachash. In their drunken state, they brought strange fire to the altar of God, which represented the fire of Egypt and the fire of the Nachash, and God reached out and killed them because of their violation. And the Bible says, here Aaron is about ready to grieve, and all the nation of Israel with him, and God says, don't you grieve. You don't realize the depth of the violation they just did. And the beginning of this verse here is the Lord spake unto Aaron, do not drink wine nor strong drink, nor thy sons with thee, when ye go up into the tabernacle of the congregation. From this day forward, you always enter into the presence of God sober. Because if you're drunk, you do something stupid. Boy, shouldn't that be a lesson for everybody? When you're drunk, you do stupid stuff, and sometimes you do stupid stuff that all the repentance in the world cannot change the consequences of what you did when you were drunk. Selah. Boy, we need to put butters in. Sometimes it's like you can hear from heaven, dun-dun! Don't get stupid in your service to God. It needs to be exact. Now, let me tell you something. The first time you go on a date with a woman, guys, there's a protocol that you should follow. Those of you that are of dating age, listen up. You open the door for the girl. You always treat her like a lady. You pay for the meals. You pay for the chocolate. You pay for the flowers. There's a certain protocol. And your job is not to act like a goofy doofus. Now that is hard for guys because guys resort to goofy doofus mode when they're nervous. But no woman wants to marry a goofy doofus. She wants to marry a man who knows what it means to be a man. When you go into the presence of God, it should be exact. You go in by the blood of Jesus. You go in the name of Jesus, and you make sure everything in your life lines up with that blood and that name. That's when you start getting things done in the spirit realm. Oh, that's a whole nother series. Both the doofus and the other. Maybe I need to write a book, Men, How Not to Be Stuck on Stupid. Maybe, I don't know. That may be the next one after this one. It says, And the Lord spake unto Aaron, saying, Do not drink wine nor strong drink, thou nor thy sons with thee, when thou goest into the tabernacle of congregation, lest ye die, and it shall be a statute forever through your generations, that... Now he's talking about strange fire, the fire of God. You see, the fire of God had to be given by God alone, and they were required to keep it kindled. Okay. Oh! How many times have what we called been revival has been strange fire, and as long as it caused a hubbub, we called it revival and created it a movement when it was because, and we, the reason we needed that was because we did not keep the fire that came down from heaven kindled in our hearts. And so we reached for strange fire. And then sometimes you look back in church history and say, that movement died. No, it was strange fire that had to die. And right now, across the body of Christ in the charismatic movement, it's on fire with strange fire. And guys, it needs to die for the sake of the remnant. Oh, I'm wanting to get back in manifestations. But let me tell you this. If you can't find it in the Bible, how about not doing it? There's supposed to be where gold dust is falling down, you know? And gems? Well, I want to see the gems. I want them tested. Where's the gold? And for me, I'm Hebraic enough. When God gives gold, it's like this. Go fishing, Peter, and you're going to find a gold coin in the fish's mouth, and you're going to pay both our taxes. Until I start seeing enough gold to send in meetings that I can go pay my taxes, I'm not impressed. Come on now. Or if diamonds or if rubies and gems start falling from heaven, you should, and if it's a true gem, you should be able to take it and have it verified and go ahead and get your ministry out of debt and go build something. You know, it would take one meeting like that and you could finance a ministry for years. Mike, that's the biggest diamond I ever saw. Where'd that come from? Heaven. Here it is on video. What did God say? God said, go sell it and build a community. Don't need to take up an offering because God gave the offering. Can you see what I'm talking about here? We don't see that anywhere in the Bible. Why are you running after stupid things that the Nachash causes manifestations that there's really no substance to in calling it God? We're running after strange fire because we have let the fire of God go out in our hearts. Turned off. Never pound the pulpit with your fist when you have the remote control for the camera right here, because you'll turn off your own camera. So everybody, that's what happened. We're not professional here at Biblical Life. We're just anointed, okay? But we need to repent and let God take us through the process of fire descending. We can get into Mount Carmel and the whole process there. The repentance is setting things in order and then soaking it in the Word until God sends the fire. Oh, I'm trying to get back. We're getting back to Leviticus. He said, now this happened, that ye may know the difference between holy and unholy, between unclean and clean, and that may ye teach the children of Israel all the statutes which the Lord has spoken unto them by the hand of Moses. So part of the reason that we have the Torah and the commandments of God, and by the way, it's all the early church had. The Old Testament plus the revelation of who Jesus was, they turned the world upside down. And right now, the New Testament without the old, in this modified gospel that we're preaching, we can't even turn anybody's life upside down. And then we turn up our nose even at the early church. I have heard ministers of the gospel get up and say, if Paul knew what we know now, he wouldn't have had to gone through what he went through. Ladies and gentlemen, that is called being stuck on stupid. It's time for us to return to the purity of the word. If I could boil down the basic essence of the commandments, statutes, and judgments of God, there's a book out there that's written on dieting. It's called Eat This, Not That. Have you ever seen that? If you're walking through Barnes and Nobles or Walmart, Eat This and Not That. And what he shows you is, here's all the foods that we eat all the time that are killing us. Instead of eating those, eat these. They won't kill you. They'll actually make you healthy. That's what the commandments of God are. Do this, not that. Accept this, reject that. Walk this way, not in the way of the heathen. It is our definitions of what sin is and what righteousness is, and we have rejected it all, and now we say we have the freedom in Christ that we can redeem anything from the Nachash and make it a righteous act. No, you can't. Because the word of God is eternal. If it is that way, then we're saying God made a mistake. God was wrong when he said that this was wrong. No, that makes God a liar. What God said forever will be sin, is sin, will always be sin. What he said is a righteous act will always be a righteous act. The sooner we realize that, the sooner we can start preparing the way for some real fire to come in our lives. You see, I want the kingdom. I want that kingdom alive in my heart. I want that kingdom alive in my life. And to do that, I've got to start setting things in order. Don't be like the guy that gets a new piece of furniture for the house that has 100,000 pieces to it and sets the instructions aside and think that that edifice is going to stand when he gets it done. That's what we've done. We've thrown away the instructions and say, I know enough to put it together myself because it feels right. The Bible says the heart is wicked. It's easy to be deceived. And how many times have we been deceived into unrighteousness because it felt right? It will always feel right to your flesh. And the whole time your spirit man screaming in the background, don't do it! Well, why can't I hear my spirit more? Because you spend most of your time starving him to death. Because he feeds on this and the presence of God. Guys, one of the things I'm trying to do with all my heart, and I've got my Bible everywhere. I got my Bible here. There's not a computer that I have that doesn't have the Bible on it. There's not a tablet that I have that doesn't have the Bible on it. It's on my phone. I can do researches in my phone that the Apostle Paul probably would have loved to have had. It's almost the same power I have on my laptop. And I will purposely stop and bring one up during the day, even though I'm busy, and try to get some word in. And I will find a section of scripture, and I may read it the same one 4 or 5 times during the day and just chew on it all day. Why? Because I'm after meat, and meat takes a while to chew to get the worth out of it. And I ask the Holy Spirit, Lord, help me chew the meat today. Speak to me as I'm meditating on that word. People say, you know, I read 40 chapters a day. Yeah, but how much of it do you remember? Wouldn't it be better to take 2 or 3 verses and chew on that for 2 or 3 days and let the Holy Spirit show you 40 things out of it that you remember? And teaching you how to set things in order. This is clean. This is unclean. This is my kingdom. This is not my kingdom. Do this. Don't do that. This is God's kingdom. This is the devil's kingdom that we were delivered out of. Don't yield yourself to the tyranny of the familiar. Well, I always knew what to expect with Pharaoh, so at least it's not the unknown. The unknown with God is so much better than the tyranny of the Pharaoh. Come on. I don't know what's in the desert ahead of me, but I have been promised the promised land. I have been promised that if I'll hear his voice and obey it, I'm going to cross my Jordan. And guys, we're in a pivotal time right now in history. A lot of us are on the verge of crossing the Jordan. Either you can turn back in unbelief, or you can go ahead and put your foot in the water, because the water's fine, and you're supposed to be one of the priests carrying the ark of his presence. Oh, Father, I just pray for everyone that listens to this today. Father, let us have a shot of spiritual testosterone to be the men and women that you have called us to be, to walk in your ways, to walk in your statutes, to always glorify Jesus, and to make sure that what we do lines up with his character and his nature and his purpose for us in the earth. Father, I thank you and I praise you for it today. In Jesus' name.